Welcome to Perspective from IIM Bangalore. Today we have with us a gentleman who has a rare combination of political maturity with intellectual wisdom. Former Union Finance Minister, Mr. P. Chidambaram. Welcome to IIM Bangalore, sir. So my first question to you is about the GDP series data. The GDP series data actually shows that the growth in manufacturing in the last quarter of 2015 was 12%, while the IIP data shows it's only 0.9%. So I want to understand what is the reason behind the anomaly in this data.
Nobody has explained it so far. I have defended the CSO numbers for many years in the past, and therefore I do not want to debunk the numbers. I think the CSO says that it is capturing value addition in many, many more sectors of the economy with much larger database. But on the ground, the IIP numbers don't seem to reflect this kind of robust manufacturing growth. In fact, MSMEs are in very bad shape, very stressed. If you look at the balance sheets of large firms, there are clear signs of stress. Operating profits are low, interest coverage ratios low, debt is rising. I think that's why the RBI is using both sets of numbers to make a more realistic assessment. Clearly, the manufacturing sector is not growing at the rate in which at which the GDP numbers indicate. It's growing at a much lower rate. But if the CSO is the only organization that gives us the numbers, I'm afraid we'll have to live with it until we have better data.
So another thing is, in a recent article as well as in the lecture right now, you mentioned that India needs to move from a consumption-driven economy to an investment-driven economy, and services led to manufacturing that. The recent data also suggests that we are moving in similar direction through a Make in India campaign, promoting the manufacturing in India, as well as the FDI has increased 48% by 48% since 2014. What are your thoughts on that?
Dude, I thought in my lecture I did explain the two aspects that you mentioned. FDI is range bound in this country, between 35 billion to 45 billion. So I don't think there is any sudden jump in the FDI inflow. Secondly, one must look at FDI, must slice it in two parts. How much FDI is simply replacing Indian capital, and how much FDI is adding to the stock of Indian, or stock of capital. See, if an Indian entrepreneur has invested 50 crore and he's selling out to a foreigner who replaces it with dollar capital, that's not additional capital in industry. While I welcome the FDI inflow and the rise over last year and over the previous year, about not very good years, I think FDI is pretty much range bound so far. I don't see any quantum jump, but hopefully there will be a quantum jump. The second part of your question was about Make in India. I did explain. There is no difference between the previous government and the present government. In fact, it is the new policy which was announced is simply a cut and paste of old policy. But that's nothing wrong with that. And policies can't be abruptly changed in a year or so. The policy framework is sound. We fail because we are unable to implement a project in the planned time. There are too many uncertainties. Too many unanticipated hurdles, too many roadblocks. So at some point of time, the guy just gives up. And how do I break through these hurdles? I think we must have far greater administrative capacity to be able to pave a smooth road for the entrepreneur to invest and implement his project. The problem is not about conceiving a project. The problem is in implementation.
But the government seems to be working to make it more business friendly by reducing the regulations.
But I welcome it, but the proof of the pudding is in the eating. I need to see at the end of the year how many new industries have come, how many greenfield industries have come.
Sir, there has always been a lot of focus on growth, like India has to grow at like 7%, 6%. So another thing that is growing a lot of late is inequality, income inequality. So the last heard, the top 100 richest Indians have more wealth than 2/3 of the entire population. So do you think that we are like losing focus on the welfare policies and like too much focused on growth or economic growth of our country?
You are right, but that is inevitable in a transitioning economy. We are transiting from a controlled economy to a regulated economy. We are transiting from a largely non-market economy to a market economy. We are allowing entrepreneurs to rise and flourish. So those who do not have entrepreneurial skills, those who do not have high education, those who do not have the special skills that are necessary to traverse your way through a market economy, you will be left behind. Inequalities will increase. I'm not justifying it, I'm just giving a statement of fact. Inequalities will increase in the initial years. But that is why the state must step in. And through intelligent taxation and through support to the sections that are left behind, the state must reduce the inequalities. That inequalities will increase is well known, it's a given in fact. We cannot hope for high growth and expect that inequalities won't increase. It will happen. The early winners will be those with skills and those with entrepreneurial qualities. The losers will be the rest. The state must step in and bridge the inequality. That is why we think the state has a very major role to play, even in a market economy.
Sir, another thing is, so UPA in 2012 brought in 51% FDI multi-bank retail. But if we look at the latest reports from the current government, they are not very keen on allowing FDI multi-bank retail. So we'd like to hear your take on this.
It's complete foolishness. What is a mall? A mall is multi-brand retail, except that each shop is owned by a different person. And if you can have a mall with every brand there, why can't you allow one man to have one roof with every brand there? But once you say this is dependent upon the state adopting the multi-brand retail policy or not, the investor is afraid. He's afraid that tomorrow the state may simply pull the plug and say, pack up and go. Remember 1977, Coca-Cola was asked to pack up and go. Therefore, he's afraid, why should I invest when there's so much uncertainty? How can you have a policy at the central level with a veto to the state? I mean, this is a complete contradiction, which is pointed out at that time. Don't do this. Don't have a policy at the central level and give a veto to the state. And with so many elections taking place every year and governments changing, who will have the confidence to invest in a climate of uncertainty?
So do you think it would make sense if we had phased elections as in like US, where they have elections every 2 years and not every year?
No, we can't have elections every 2 years.
In terms of like 50% states having 2 years.
The US is, the US House of Representatives elected every 2 years. The US is 1/4 the size of India in terms of the electorate. It's a rich country. Elections there are not the elections here, because they mainly communicate through television. I was in England when the last election took place. I desperately tried to attend an election meeting. There was no election meeting to attend. I said, is there some rally, some procession, some event happening in connection with the election? And everybody looked back at me, what a strange question. We don't have that kind of elections here. Therefore, I think it's not possible to have elections in this country every 2 years. I think what has happened is because the cycle of state elections and the cycle of parliament elections have become different for a variety of reasons. We seem to have elections every year, but I don't think it's possible with 29 states and with different political parties and different reasons why governments are formed or governments fall, it's possible to synchronize the state election with the central election. As far as possible, most states must go to election along with parliament.
And so recently we have heard the news that many of these public banks, they have like declared a lot of non-performing assets and bad loans. So this somewhat reminds us of the subprime crisis of 2018 in US. Do you think there is a new possibility of India going into recession because of growth?
I don't think so. This is a regulatory failure, lax supervision and lax regulation led banks to lend to accounts to which they should not have lent. Now, if growth had been maintained at 7-8%, this problem would never have surfaced. The loans would have been repaid. But with poor quality lending, that problem is compounded by falling growth. When growth fell, industries are unable to repay the loans. Now, the normal response to this should be handhold the companies for a year or two more until they come out of this cycle and begin to repay the loans, which is what I believe the banks and the government did for about 2 years. But now even that handholding is not helping because the recession is still not over. The global recession is still not over. Exports are falling. Commodity prices are low, oil prices are low, which is in a sense beneficial to companies where these are inputs. And therefore, even the hand-holding of 2 years has not helped enough. Our question is, should you continue to hand-hold these companies for another 2-3 years, or should you simply tighten up before the bank's balance sheet worsens? This is a call which the regulator has to take. The RBI has taken a call. Some aspects of it appear to be impractical, but I don't want to second guess the regulator. Let's see what the outcome is.
So one question I would like to ask you about is, UK government has supported goods and services tax before as well. And in principle, they have said that they continue to support. But we do not see the bill getting passed through the parliament.
This bill should not be passed. This bill is a flawed bill. There are three major defects in the bill. There's no cap on the GST rate. The 1% additional duty is a retro rate provision. And the dispute resolution mechanism has not been spelled out in the bill. If these three problems are fixed, the bill can be passed next week.
So my question is, why are these problems not addressed?
You should ask the government. We have given our objections in writing and pointed out the faults and said, please address these problems.
So the last question would be, would you like to give any message to the students of IIM Bangalore?
Well, I don't think anyone should give messages to the young generation. I hope many of you become entrepreneurs. I know that many of you will take up jobs. There's nothing wrong in taking up jobs. Even when you hold a job, you can think of yourself as an entrepreneur, rather than simply as a somebody who holds a job. So I think what will drive India's economy is more and more people discovering the innate entrepreneurial skills. In fact, before many nations became trading nations, India was one of the world's leading maritime trading nations. They ventured as far as Java and Sumatra, ventured as far as Rome, I think basically we are an entrepreneurial people. Thanks to a closed economy, a non-market economy, 2-3 generations of Indians lost their entrepreneurial skills. Now we have unleashed it. So either you should become an entrepreneur, or even if you're holding a job in a large corporation, you must regard yourself as an entrepreneur.
So on the behalf of Forum for Industrial Interaction with Student Media Cell, I would like to thank you for
that. Thank you.